Frostbite, Chapter 3. The lobby of my dorm was a buzz when I sprinted downstairs to my before-school practice. The commotion don't surprise me. A good night's sleep had gone far to chase away the images from last night, but I know neither I nor my classmates could easily forget what had taken place outside Billings. And yet, I studied the faces and cluster of the known voices. I noticed something weird. The fear and tension from yesterday were still around, certainly, but something new was there too. Excitement. A couple of fresher men non-voice was practically squeezing with joy as they spoke in hushed whispers. Nearby, a group of guys my own age were gesturing widely, enthusiastically, grins on their faces. I had to be missing something here, unless all of my yesterday had been a dream. It took every ounce of my self-control I had not to go over and ask somebody what was happening. If I delayed, I could be late for practice. The curiosity was killing me, though. Had the Strigoi and their humans been found and killed? That could certainly be good news, but something told me that was not the case. Pushing open the front door, I lamented that I could just have to wait until breakfast to find out. Hard way, don't run away, a sing-song voice called. I glanced behind me and grinned. Manson Osborne, another unknown non-voice and good friend of mine, jogged up and fell in step with me. What are you, 12? I asked, continuous on towards the gym. Nearly, he said. I missed your smiling face yesterday. Where were you? Apparently, my presence at Berica House still was not widely known. It was not a secret or anything, but I don't want to discuss any gory details. Had a training thing with Drummond. God, muttered Manson. That guy is always working you. Does not he realize he is depriving us of your beauty and charm? Smiling face, beauty and charm. You are laying it on a little thick this morning, or not you? I laughed. Hey, I'm just telling it like this. Really, you're lucky to have someone as savior and brilliant as me paying this much attention to you. I kept grinning. Manson was a huge flirt and he liked to flirt with me in particular. Part of it was just because I was good at it and liked to flirt back. But I know his feelings towards me were more than just friendly, and I was still deciding how I felt about that. He and I had the same goofy sense of humor and frequently draw attention to ourselves in class and among friends. He had gorgeous blue eyes and messy red hair that never seems to lie flat. It was cute. But dating someone new was going to kind of difficult when I still kept thinking about the time I was half-nagged in bed with Drummond. Survey and brilliant? Huh? I shook my head. I don't think you pay nearly as much attention to me as you do your ego. Someone needs to knock it down a little. Oh yeah, he asked. Well, you can try your best to on the slopes. I stopped walking. The what? The slopes, he titled his head. You know, the sky trip. What sky trip? I was apparently missing something serious here. Where have you been this morning? He asked, looking at me like I was a crazy woman. In bed. I only got up like 5 minutes ago. Now, start from the beginning and tell me what you're talking about. I shivered from the lack of movement. And let's keep walking. We did. So you know how everyone is afraid to have their kids home for Christmas. Well, there is this huge sky lodge in Edo that's exclusively used by royals and rich morai. The people who own it are opening it for academic students and their families, and actually any other morai who want to go, with everyone in one spot. They are going to have a lot of guardians to protect the place, so it will be totally safe. You cannot be serious, I said. We reached the gym and stepped inside out of the cold. Manson nodded eagerly. It's true. The place is supposed to be amazing. He gave me a grin that always made me smile in return. We are going to live like royalty, Rose, at least for a week or so. We take off the day after Christmas. I stood there, both excitement and stunned. I had not seen this coming. It really was a brilliant idea, one that left families reunite safely, and what a reunion spot. Your Royal Sky Lodge. I could expect it to spend most of my holiday break hanging out here and watching TV with Lisa and Christian. Now, I could be living it up in five-star accommodations, lobster dinners, massages, cute sky instructors. Manson, enthusiasm was contagious. I could feel it wheeling up in me, and then suddenly it slammed to a halt. Studying his face, he was the change right away. What's wrong? This is cool. It is, I admitted, and I get why everyone is excited. But the reason we are getting to go to this fancy place is because people are dead. I mean, does not this all seem weird? Manson's cheery expression sobered a little. Yeah, but we are alive, Rose. We cannot stop living because other people are dead, and we have to make sure other people don't die. That is why this place is such a great idea. It is safe. His eyes turned stormy. God, I cannot wait until we are out of here in the field. After hearing about what happened, I just want to go and tear apart some strigoi. I wish we could go now. You know, there is no reason. They could use the extra help, and we pretty much know everything we need to. That fierceness in his voice reminded me of my outburst yesterday, though he was not quite as worked up as I could be. His eagerness to act was impulsions and navy. Weirdness mine had been born out of my some weird, dark, irritational, I still could not entirely understand. When I don't respond, Manson gave me a puzzled look. Don't you want to? I don't know, Mass. I started down at the floor, avoiding his eyes as I studied the toe of my shoe. I mean, I don't want Strigoi out there attacking people either, and I want to stop them in theory. But well, we are not even close to being ready. I have seen what they can do. I don't know. Rushing in is not the answer. I shook my head and looked back up. Good grief, I sounded so logical and cashin. I sounded like Drimmit. It's not important since it is not going to happen anyway. I suppose we should just be excited about the trip, huh? Manson's moods were quick to change and he turned easygoing once more. Yeah, and you could better try to remember how to sky because I'm calling you out on knocking down my ego out there. No, not that it is going to happen. I smiled again. Boy, it sure is going to be sad when I make you cry. I kind of feel guilty already. He opened his mouth, no doubt to deliver some smart-ass reply, and then caught sight of something, or rather, someone behind me. I glanced over and saw Drimmit's tall form approaching from other side of the gym. Manson swept to me, Golian bow. Your order, your lord and master. Catch you later, Hathaway. Start planning your sky strategies. He opened the door and disappeared into the fridge darkness. I turned around and joined Drimmit. Like other dampier non-voice, I spent half of my school day on one form or another of guardian training, but it actually physical combat or learning about strigoi and how to defend against them. Non-voice also sometimes had practice after school. I, however, was an unique situation. I still stood by my decision to run away from Stain Valdemix. Victor Deshwak has posed too much of threat to Lisa, but our extended vacation had come to with consequences. Being away for 2 years had put me behind in my guardian classes, so the school had declared that I had to make up for it by going to extra practices before and after school with Drimmit. Little did they know that they were also giving me lessons in avoiding temptation. But my attraction to him aside, I was as fast a learner, and with his help, I had almost caught up to the other seniors. Since he was not wearing a coat, I knew we could be working inside today, which was good news. It was freezing out. Yet, even the happiness I felt over that was nothing compared to what I felt when I saw what exactly he had set up in one of the training rooms. They were practice dummies arranged on the firewall, dummies that looked amazingly lifelike. No stroke buffed ballage bags here. There were men and women wearing ordinary clothes with ruby skin and different hair and eye colors. Their expression ranged from happy to scared to anger. I could worked with these dummies before in other trainings, using them to practice kicks and punches. But I could never worked with them while holding what Trimit held, a silver stick. Sweet, I breathed. It was identical to one I found at the barrack house. I had a hard hand grip at the bottom, almost like a hilt, without the little slide flourishness. That was where it resembles to a dragger ended. Rather than a flat blade, the strike had a thick, rounded body that narrowed to a point, kind of like an ice pick. The entire thing was a little shorter than my forearm. Drimit leaned casually against the wall. It is an easy stance he always pulled off remarkably well, despite being almost 6'7". With one hand, he tossed the stake in the air. It spun around in a catwheel a couple of times and then came down. He caught it, hilt first. Please tell me I get to learn how to do that today, I said. Amusement flashed in the dark depth of his eyes. I think he had a hard time keeping a straight face around me sometimes. You'll be lucky if I let you hold it today, he said. He flipped the stake into the air again. My eyes followed it longingly. I started to point out that I had already held one, but I knew the line of logic could get me nowhere. Instead, I toasted my backpack on the floor, tore off my coat, and crossed my arms exceptionally. I had no loose pants tied to the waist and a tank top with a hoodie over it. My dark hair was pulled brutally back into a ponytail. I was ready for anything. You want me to tell you how they work and why I should always be cashing around them? I announced. Drimit stopped flipping the stake and stared at me in astonishment. Come on, I laughed. You don't think I know how you work by now? We have been doing this for almost 3 months. You always make me talk safety and responsibility before I can do anything fun. I see, he said. Well, I guess I have got it all figured out. By all means, go on with the lesson. I will just wait over here until you need me again. He tucked the stack into a leather shelf hanging from his belt and then made himself comfortable against the wall, hands stuffed in his pockets. I waited, figuring he was joking, but he said nothing else. I realized he could mean his word. With a search, I launched into what I knew. Silver always has powerful effect on any magical creation. It can help or hurt them if you put through enough power into it. These stakes are really hardcore because it takes 4 different moirai to make them, and they use each of the elements during the forging. I frowned at suddenly considering something. Well, except spirit. So these things are supercharged and are about to only non-delpectable weapon that can do damage to a strigoi, but to kill them, it has to be through the heart. Will they hurt you? I shook my head. No, I mean, well, yeah, if you drive a one through my heart, it will. But it won't hurt me like it could hurt a moirai. Scratch one of them with this and it will hit them pretty hard, but not as hard as it could hit a strigoi. And they won't hurt humans either. I stopped for a moment and stared absently at the window behind Remit. Frost covered the glass in sparkling, crystalline patterns, but I hardly noticed. Mentioning humans and stakes had transported me back to Barrica House. Blood and death flashed through my thoughts. Seeing Drimitz watching me, I shook off the memories and kept going with the lessons. Drimitz could occasionally give a nod or ask a clarifying question. As the time ticked down, I kept expecting him to tell me I was finished and could start hacking up the dummies. Instead, he waited until almost 10 minutes before the end of the session before leaning me over to one of them. It was a man with blond hair and a goat. Drummond took the stake out from his sheath, but don't hand it to me. Where are you going to put this? He asked. In the heart, I replied irritably. I already told you that like 1,000 times. Can I have it now? He almost smiled himself. Where is the heart? I gave him a "Are you serious?" look. He merely shushed with overdramatic emphasis. I pointed to the left side of the dummy's chest. Drimit shook his head. That is not where the heart is, he told me. Sure it is. People put their hands over their hearts when they say the Pledge of Allegiance or sing the national anthem. He continued to stare at me exceptionally. I turned back to the dummy and studied it. In the back of my brain, I remembered learning CPR and where we had to place our hands. I tapped to the center of the dummy's chest. It is there? He asked and bro. Normally, I thought that was cool. Today, it was just annoying. I don't know, he said. Is it? That is what I'm asking you. You should not have to ask me. Don't you all have to ask for psychology? Yeah, junior year. I was on vacation, remember? I pointed to the gleaming stake. Can I please touch it now? He flipped the stake again, letting it flash in the light, and then it disappeared into the shield. I want you to tell me where the heart is the next time we met. Exactly where. And I want to know what is the way of it too. I gave him my best glare, which, judging from his expression, must not have been that fierce. 9 out of 10 times, I thought. Drimit was the sexiest thing walking the earth. Then there are times like this. I headed off to the first period, your combat class, in a bad mood. I don't like looking incomplete in front of Drimit. And I could really, really wanted to use one of those tacks. So in class, I took out my annoyance on anyone I could punch or kick. By the end of the class, no one wanted to spar with me. I could accidentally hit Meredith, one of the few other girls in my class, so hard that she could left felt it through her shin padding. She was going to have an ugly bruise and kept looking at me as though I could have done it on purpose. I apologized to no avail. Afterward, Manson found me once again. Oh man, he said, studying my face. Who pissed you off? I immediately launched into my tale of silver stake and heart wars. To my annoyance, he laughed. How do you not know where the heart is, especially considering how many of them you have broken? I gave him the same furious look I could have given Drummond. This time it worked. Manson's face paled. Beloved is a sick, evil man who should be thrown into a pit of rabid vipers for the great offense he committed against you this morning. Thank you, I said primly. Then I considered. Can vipers be a rabid? I don't say why not. Everything can be, I think. He held the hallway door open for me. Canadian geese might be worse than vipers, though. I gave him a sidelong look. Canadian geese are deadlier than vipers? You ever tried to feed those little bastards? He asked, attempting to be serious and failing. They are vicious. You get thrown to vipers, you die quickly. But geese? That is, go on for days, more suffering. Wow, I don't know where I should be impressed or frightened that you have thought about all this, I remarked, just trying to find creative ways to avenge your honor, that's all. You just never struck me as the creative type, Mass. We stood just outside our second period classroom. Manson's expression was still light and joking, but there was a suggestive note in his voice when we spoke again. Rose, when I'm around you, I think all sorts of creative things to do. I was still giggling about the vipers and abruptly stopped, staring at him in surprise. I could always thought Manson was cute, but with that serious, smoky look in his eyes, it suddenly occurred to me for the first time that he was actually kind of sexy. Oh, look at that. He laughed, noticing how much he caught me off guard. Rose gets redness, speechlessness. Ashford 1, Hathaway 0. Hey, I don't want to make you cry before the trip. It won't be any fun if I have already broken you before we even hit the slopes. He laughed and we stepped into the room. This was a class on bodyguard theory, one that took place in actual classroom instead of the practice field. It was nice break from all the physical exertion. Today, there were three guardians standing at the front who were not from the school's regiment. Holidays visitors, I realized, parents and their guardians have already started coming to campus to accompany their children to the Sky Resort. My interest was piqued immediately. One of the guests was a tall guy who looked like he was about 100 years old but could still kick major ass. The other guy was about Drummond's age. He had deeply tanned skin and was built well enough that a few of the girls in class looked ready to squirm. The last guardian was a woman. Her auburn hair was cropped and curly, and her brown eyes was currently narrowed in thought. As I have said, a lot of vampire women choose to have children rather than follow the guardian path. Since I too was one of the few women in the profession, I was always excited to meet others like Tamra. Only this was not Tamra. This was someone I could known for years. Someone who triggered anything but pride and excitement. Instead, I felt resentment, anger, and burning outrage. The woman standing in front of the glass was my mother.